Right. Hymns and her. Well, I hope you've brought your harmonious voices to this session, because I think we're in for a good sing. It's my joy and privilege to welcome Pam Rhodes to our annual conference. We all think we know you, Pam. Because for those of us who watch Songs of Praise on a Sunday, you're a very familiar face. And I don't know about anyone else, but I feel I've known you forever. Pam has a wonderful knowledge of hymns and stories about their writers. But before I hand you over to Pam, shall we begin with a prayer? Lord, the sounds of the world surround us in our daily lives. The song of a bird, the honk of a horn, the clatter of pans in the kitchen, the mighty wind and the gentle whisper of the breeze, our chatter with friends and the music of the radio. We praise you for the gifts of hearing and sound, and for the way in which we can express our feelings for you through words and melodies. Be with us now as we learn about the writers of familiar hymns and those who compose the tunes. We pray for Pam that she will inspire us to sing your praises with new insight as we worship you. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Hello. We do feel as if we've known each other for years, don't we? Yes. So I'm going to start with a question. How old is Songs of Praise? How old are you? Because it's most of our lives, isn't it, really? What do you think? Yeah, 62 this year. I just thought I'd make it clear that I haven't been presenting it for 62 years, but for 36 years. And I realise now that I might be ticking the diversity box as the OAP member, but I am so pleased to still be there. And it is a programme which is held in such love and affection, as you know. And I think that people really engage with those who are brave enough and generous enough to talk about their own experience. Ordinary people who are extraordinary, as each and every one of us is. But, of course, we love the hymns, especially since we put the words up at the back, bottom of the screen, and we know that it's the biggest karaoke in the world. And isn't it lovely to think that we're all singing together? But, you know, hymns are interesting because I think the essence of a hymn is that it unites us all in the human experience. And it really doesn't matter if it's a psalmist writing 3,000 years ago, or Stuart Townend, or Matt Redman, or Keith Getty writing today. It's how they feel when they wrote it, what they were praying for, where they were giving to God, whether they felt in need of guidance or courage or protection or just wanted to praise. That experience of emotion that they have is in their words. And when those words meet just the right piece of music, we never forget those hymns, do we? I bet you know all the words of Jesus Wants Me for a Sunbeam that you remember singing. Or those hymns that just mark special times in our lives, that just bring back memories of people we've loved, moments that we've cherished, or moments of great emotion, deep sorrow or deep joy. And in fact, it was Martin Luther, the great reformer, more than 500 years ago now, who was a musician who loved writing hymns, one of the earliest to do so. And at one point, he stood up in his pulpit and he held up the Bible and he said, "This is the word of the Lord." And he held up his hymn book in the other hand and he said, "This is how we remember it." And isn't that true? So we're going to remember quite a lot of hymns. But actually, when you look through the hymn book, it's quite distressing to see that probably 95% of them have got men's names against the words and the music. We know women are as creative as men ever were, but we're going to look at some of the hymns written by women, or hymns that have really meant a lot to women or a particular woman over the years. And I'm going to start with a woman that I would so have loved to have met, Fanny Crosby. Is that a name you recognise? Yes. Victorian lady in America. She wrote about 8,000 hymn texts, and they're just the ones that we know about, because apparently she wrote under pseudonyms as well. Sometimes she'd write 3 hymn texts a day, and so many of those hymns are still heard and sung by us now. But it's interesting because her life started in quite a tragic way. Born perfectly healthy, about 3 days into her life, she got a slight infection in her eyes, and her parents called the doctor. Their normal doctor wasn't there, a locum stood in, and he thought the best treatment was to put boiling hot poultices on the child's eyes and blinded her. She had very, very little sight throughout all of her life, but she actually had the love of 2 wonderful women, not just her mother, but her grandmother was a great influencer in her life. She taught her really to remember everything. She painted the world in colour and in personality through her words. She shared it with her granddaughter. She learned to speak other languages, and she learned a lot of the Bible just by memory. She had such a wonderful knowledge of her faith and a huge enthusiasm for the world around her and people that she met. And she lived until she was 92. And when she was in her 90s, somebody said to her, "Isn't it a shame that you've never been able to see what the world is like all around you? All your life you've not been able to see." And she just smiled and said, "Do you know what? I don't mind, because I know that the very first face that I will ever see will be that of my Lord," which is a lovely way for us to start. So shall we stand, if you'd like to sing, "To God Be the Glory"? We're going to have such fun singing today. I'm really looking forward to this. And actually, that's one of those songs, isn't it, with words that you really don't need the script for. It's wonderful how we do remember words like that. But, you know, you get to a certain age and you find that your memory lets you down a bit, don't you? Has anyone else ended up in the supermarket with 1 red shoe and 1 black shoe? No. Or with looking for your glasses and then realising you've got 1 pair on your head and 1 on your nose. No. Is that only me or no? My daughter says that my worst crime is that this girl I've known all her life, I will call her 3 wrong names. before I get to the right one. And she said it wouldn't be so bad if those names didn't all belong to dearly loved but definitely departed family pets. So I can see her point. But I have, for many decades, I think probably for about 30 years, I have been a patron of Methodist Homes for the Aged, MHA. You will know them well. What a wonderful, wonderful organisation that is. I'm so thrilled to be part of it. And you'll know that, of course, that they have a special care for those with dementia at whatever stage it is. And this is an absolutely true story. That in one of our homes, two new residents arrived more or less at the same time. And almost met on the mat, the welcoming mat, and it was all a bit worrying and everything, and something happened just arriving at that point. They connected and they made friends, and it was quite a sort of distinguished military man called Joe and a little Irish lady called Mary, and their friendship was very important to them. And actually, over a period of time, that friendship blossomed into romance. And eventually Joe plucked up courage to ask Mary to marry him. And she said, yes! And they were so excited, and they spent the next couple of hours talking about what the future would be. And then it was nearly time for tea. So they went back to their separate rooms to meet again at tea time. And it was when he got behind his own door, Joe thought, I know I did ask Mary to marry me, but did she say yes? And he was so worried about it that he hurtled down the corridor and banged on her door. And when she opened the door, he blurted all this out. And she said, oh, Joe, I'm so glad you came, because I knew I said yes to someone. But I wasn't sure who. Actually, we shouldn't laugh, should we? Because it could happen to any of us. Anyway, we're going right back to our childhood now, to the hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful. That's right. That's going to bring back memories for many of us. Written by a wonderful lady, I'm sure we would all love to have met, Cecil Frances Alexander, in spite of having a man's name as her first name. She was a wonderful lady. She'd grown up in a Christian home. She was a Sunday school teacher from being a teenager, and she always had a heart for children. And she married a young priest, William, who eventually went on to become primate, sort of the equivalent of archbishop of the whole of Ireland. And they had a wonderful life together, a very happy marriage. And actually, she wanted to make sure that children could always understand perhaps the more complex ideas of the message of the gospel. And the creed, which actually states what we believe, there was wording in that which she thought was quite difficult. So, born of the Virgin Mary, she put that into simple poetry for children, and she wrote, Once in Royal David City, to just tell the story. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. She wrote, There is a green hill far away. And to illustrate the meaning of maker of heaven and earth, she wrote, all things bright and beautiful. And they had a long and happy marriage, but she did die before William. And some years later, he said very wryly, he said, you know, I've had a wonderful career. I hope I've done well and left the world a better place for me being here. But I do know that I will only ever be remembered as the man who married the woman who wrote All Things Bright and Beautiful. Shall we stand to sing this childhood favourite?
Thank you.
lovely, took you back to childhood. It's the right kind of time of year, isn't it, to sing that? As I drove into the hay sedge, all those lovely daffodils at the side. I love daffodils. I just think we have so much to thank God for. And actually, it reminded me that for a couple of years on Songs of Praise, I did a series called Village Praise, where we went to little tiny villages, and it was throughout the 6 weeks of Lent, so daffodils were very much part of that. It was lovely. We probably sung this hymn quite a lot of times. So one of the great joys, whether it's a big church or a small church, is meeting members of the clergy up and down the country, because that they are such characters, especially I think some of the Anglican ones. It's often spread very thin, doing a great job in all sorts of different situations. But the very first minister I met on Village Praise was in the little village of Guiting Power, and he was a lovely chap called David. And because we were there for the whole week, we literally parked up our outside broadcast vehicles on the village green and recorded the hymns and met everybody. We were there for a week and then moved on so that it would be ready to do one for the following week. It was May that week. And I can't tell you how many people popped up to me and said, I wish you were here on a Sunday morning. David is wonderful, they said, but his wife sits in the front seat, and when he gets up to do the sermon, she starts looking at her watch. And exactly 10 minutes later, she'll say, right, that's enough, David, sit down now. And he did. So I'm just passing it on in case it's useful information for any of you to know. But from very humble little programs like that comes memories of incredible events, live Songs of Praise programs. There are times when it doesn't happen now, actually, in the present sort of way in which Songs of Praise is made, but we would often do live programs which were an immediate response to something that the whole nation was going through, perhaps fear or celebration or shock. And I think it was shock, most of all, that meant that there was that day at the end of August when we woke up to hear the news that Princess Diana had been killed in a car crash overnight. It was a Sunday morning, and I was in Norfolk in the middle of nowhere interviewing a farmer for Songs of Praise about planting trees for the future when the phone call came through saying, can you get down to London straight away? We're going to do a live broadcast this afternoon. And at that point, they didn't even know where it would be. But by the time I got out of my welly boots and down to London, it was St Paul's, where, of course, we have that image in our mind of them getting married, don't we? And St Paul's Cathedral, which in many ways is the parish church of the nation, I think. And we were there, and we had to put a programme together in just a few hours before 6 o'clock. Well, it used to take 3 days to light St Paul's Cathedral, and the BBC team got those lights up so quickly. The local people, the local ministers, put out a plea for people to come and fill that great cathedral, which they did. There was no choir. It was in the middle of the holidays. They brought a choir down from Cambridge. And I think that's where Songs of Praise comes into its own. That opportunity, on a day when there was so much comment and news and everybody had an opinion on everything, but it was just managing to bring all of those emotions and thoughts down to prayer, really. What really do we want to pray about? Put it into our context where God can help us deal with it. And I will never forget that great church, normally when people come into a Songs of Praise, they're chattering, as people do. They all come in and natter, and absolute silence as people walked in, and that sort of stunned silence remained. And the sense of moment when I introduced live that programme from St Paul's Cathedral that night was just something I will never forget. And what I do remember is in the middle of that programme, I heard in my earpiece that the plane carrying Diana's body was just about to land in West London, and the newsroom wanted to go back and cover it with more commentary. And actually, the senior producer in that newsroom, who I have met since, made the decision that we should stay with St Paul's and the music over those pictures, because the pictures spoke for themselves. And I only mention that I met him because he has subsequently become a vicar. We had the right man in the right seat. But it was wonderful to have that prayerful moment when no words were needed. And at the end of the programme, I mean, we were all stunned and all emotional. And the church emptied, and the choir went home, and so did the ministers of St Paul's, and it was just the BBC and me just clearing up our bits and pieces. But that great cathedral, as churches often do when there are big questions that you want to ask and just be in the right atmosphere, it filled up again. It was at least half full again within about half an hour because people had seen it live going out. And there was nobody to minister to them. And then suddenly, I will never know where this came from or who it was, but what sounded like a young woman, just as clear as a bell over all our heads, started singing, "Be still for the presence of the Lord." And it makes me go goosey just to think of it again now. It was so prayerful. It was so right. And we were so aware of the presence of God at that point. After all the words, all the pomp, all the commentary, all the pain, all the shock, all the emotions, God was with us in that moment. So I would like us to sing, "Be still for the presence of the Lord." And we'll sit and sing it prayerfully as we did on that day. Thanks, Jenny. Charity, whether it's a local charity or a national one. We're very inventive when it comes to raising funds for what we know are good causes. And I have a very dear old friend, Lynn, who lives down in Plymouth, and she belongs to a ladies' guild in her church. And they had a formidable chairwoman, Margaret, who decreed that on the first Saturday morning in December, the ladies of the ladies' guild would have a cake sale, which was very popular because they were so good at baking cakes, and everyone would have to make their contribution on the Saturday morning. Now, Lynn loves baking, but had just, on this particular occasion, taken a full-time job, so she wasn't going to be able to do much cooking in advance. She wouldn't even be able to be there on the Saturday morning, but nevertheless, came home from work on Friday evening, did what she'd done a thousand times, knocked up a chocolate cake, did it right, got it in the oven, and it would be the occasion when she took it out, instead of it going like that, it went, oh my hat, I haven't got time to make another one.
but we're always resourceful, aren't we? While it was still warm, she turned it upside down. She scooped at the middle. She stuffed the middle full of kitchen roll. She turned it over. She iced it beautifully. She put it in a box. She got in the car. She drove down to her daughter's house and thumped on the door. And when her daughter opened the door, she said, "See this cake? This is the cake that you are going to buy. First thing tomorrow morning, you are going to be first in the queue. No one is going to be ahead of you. You're going to buy this cake." Once she'd explained it herself, "Got it, Mum. Rely on me." So you can imagine she was on tender hooks that morning when she was at work, and eventually at about 10 past 10, her daughter rang her, she saw the call, she went, "Yes, have you got the cake?" She said, "I don't know how to tell you this, but I was first in the queue. I did go in. I couldn't see your cake anywhere." The formidable Margaret.
Also decreed that on the Sunday after the renowned cake sale, that the ladies of the league would come to her house for a buffet lunch. You're way ahead of me, because of course, as Lynn walked in, what would be right in the front of the display but her cake? She thought, "I'm going to have to own up. I'm going to have to tell Margaret what I've done." So she got up to sidle round the wall and was just about to speak when someone on the other side said, "Margaret, you've done us proud again, once again, a wonderful spread, and that cake is lovely." Margaret said, "Oh, thank you so much. I made it myself." So my friend Lynn sat back down again and thought, "There is a God." Well, someone who most definitely knows there is a God is a wonderful lady writer. She writes for the Roman Catholic community normally, Bernadette Farrell, but you will know many of her songs. She's just got this wonderful combination of writing worship music, well, since the 70s really she's been writing, which combine her gift for wonderful words, wonderful melodies, but also very challenging lyrics sometimes. She works for justice and for all sorts of community and social issue. She's a wonderful, wonderful lady, and I met her because I was sent by Songs of Praise to interview her at her home, and actually we had a lovely conversation and we've been great friends ever since. But it was at the end of that she said, "I have to tell you, I was so nervous about you coming." She said, "We bought a new loo seat just for you." You really have got to love a lady like that, haven't you? But this is one of her very best and most loved songs. Shall we stand to sing "Christ Be Our Light"?
Return to you, make us your own.
lovely. It's interesting just how varied the music is on songs of praise, the lovely lilting modern songs like that, the traditional ones as well. And one of the greatest joys for me over the years has been sitting in congregations, big and small, and singing together with all the local people. I remember one occasion when we were in Worcester Cathedral, and they'd actually asked me to sit right at the very, very back. So I was in a crowd of people there and we got chatting to each other and everything. And at one point, when have any of you been to a Songs of Praise recording, one of the old-fashioned ones in your local, well, you remember how you have to do it so many times, there's lots of rehearsals and everything. So there's a lot of stopping and starting. But at one point, the floor manager walked down the long aisle and said to all of us in our group, said, please, will you sing lustily at the start of verse 2? Please, because the camera will be in you. You'll be in vision at that point. And I said, excuse me, this is Songs of Praise. We don't have any lust on Songs of Praise. And a lady's voice not far behind me, possibly a Methodist who loves singing, said, well, we don't mind having a bit of lust, you know. If you don't want it, put it back here. We'd be happy to have it. So I'm just hoping you will always sing lustily. And I think from what we've heard already, you're already doing that. But that song, Christ Be Our Light, we're always asked, aren't we, to let our little light shine, which is all very well if you've got the confidence and feel you've got something to shine with. And it's easy to feel so insignificant and sometimes so irrelevant that you haven't got anything to offer. And this next hymn was written by a Victorian lady called Charlotte Elliot. Now, until she was 32, she was lively, popular, she was involved in all sorts of interesting projects. But she developed an illness at the age of 32, which actually made her bedbound for the rest of her life until she was 82 when she died. And she went to live with her brother, who was a vicar in Brighton. And it happened that the church in 1834, this was, were having a special Saturday morning bazaar to raise money for a new school for local children that they were trying to form. And everybody in the household was busy, and there was Charlotte upstairs in her room, not able to contribute anything. She felt really worthless. And she ended up writing verses, as she so often did, to just pour out her thoughts to God. And the result is this next hymn, Just As I Am. Just take me as I am. I haven't got anything more to offer than what I am. And actually, her brother later said, many years later, when this hymn had become so popular around many countries of the world, that actually not only did she, from her bed, thinking she was worthless, raise a huge sum of money for the school, but that she probably touched the hearts of more people when they were feeling helpless and alone than he had done in a whole lifetime of ministry. So sometimes we don't know how little actions of ours can have huge consequences. We're sowing seeds all the time, aren't we? This is a lovely hymn. Would you like to stand to sing Just As I Am?
Thank you.
got Elliot's family rallied around her when she really needed them when she became ill. And to be part of a loving family is a wonderful blessing. But any of us who are in families of various shapes and sizes will know that it can sometimes be a mixed blessing. We've got a couple, a vicar and his wife. We've got two teenage sons. And Matt got to the age in his last year at school when he was able to pass his driving test, and this was in September. So he plucked up courage at that point to say to his dad, "Now I've passed my driving test, you know, I know Christmas is a little way off, but would you consider thinking about helping me perhaps to get a car?" And his dad said, "Well, let me think about this. Actually, I think there might be three conditions. The first one would be your A-level predicted grades at the moment are C's and D's. I'd like to see them being more A's and B's. Secondly, I would like to see you reading your Bible a bit more. And thirdly, get your hair cut." So when December came round, Matt was thinking, "I probably need to broach the subject again." And so he said to his dad, "I wondered if you thought any more about it." And his dad said, "Well, actually, I have noticed your grades are now predicted to be much higher than they were before. I have been very warmed by the fact that I've seen you studying your Bible. But as I said at the start, no haircut, no car." And Matt said, "Yes, well, you see, during the times when I've been studying the Bible, I have noticed that many of the leading figures in the Bible, Moses, the disciples, even Christ himself, had long hair." And his dad said, "Yes, I'll give you that. But did you notice how everywhere they went, they walked?" We learn a thing or two as parents, don't we, as we get older. Now, this next hymn really is the story of another set of parents, Bill and Gloria Gaither. Do many of you know that name? Of course, you'll know many, many of their songs. American worship leaders, great writers of music. And this next hymn, "Because He Lives," is one of those. But the story behind it is very touching, because the timing was the end of the 60s, and Gloria was pregnant with their third child. But the world around them, especially for Americans at that time, was terrifying. There was the Vietnam War, there was a lot of civil unrest, there was the drug culture, there was violence in the streets. And they were really worried as parents that they shouldn't be bringing another child into a world that had so much challenge and so much that needed to be put right. And then a few days after that, Bill was leaving his office and he walked across a newly tarmacked car park, and he noticed in the middle of it, when the tarmac was so thick that pushing through it all was a blade of grass. And he saw that as a sign of hope and promise. And he just felt that however much challenge there is in the world around us, whether it's just in our world or the wider world, that actually, because he lives, there is hope for tomorrow. This is a wonderful song. Shall we stand to sing it if you'd like to? "Because He Lives."
Thank you.
Oh, a lot of you. And I bet, like me, you've been on one of those whistle stop trips where you're on a coach and you're on and off, aren't you? Because we all want to go there to realise that the names of places that we've known all our lives in the Bible are still there, and that there's an essence in that land that feels as if it's timeless, and we want to be there. But there are so many of them that you're literally hopping on and off the coach, aren't you? And it's a whistle-stop trip. Well, we did that, Richard and I, my husband and I, and we were in a coach with about 40 other people, and generally a very happy band, except there was a contingent in the back row who were constantly grumbling about an absolutely delightful older lady called Phyllis, who was just lovely, smiled all the time, was a charming lady, but she was always the last one back to the coach, holding everyone up when they knew they got six other places to go and have a photo and a thought about where it, what had happened there. And there was a bit of grumbling, and it was sort of, well, you know, the thing is, it's her own fault, really, that she's so slow and, you know, sort of isn't getting there on time because, well, have you seen the shoes she's wearing? Completely the wrong footwear for the very challenging terrain that we're in. And they did have a point because she was wearing a pair of sort of like just soles, like flip-flops with just a bar across that looked very big, didn't look as if they were the right size for it. So she was literally shuffling along like this, and it took ages. So I heard one of the ladies at the back say, well, she's just an accident waiting to happen. And tragically, an accident did happen. It wasn't a bad one. She was shaken rather than hurt. But she took a tumble in Bethlehem Square. And I was quite near her. And after that, Richard and I just stayed with her. We just walked with her, partly to make sure she'd get back on the coach on time, but also to just have a chance to get to know her. And what a lovely lady. She said that she had booked the ticket for this trip a whole year before, because it was the culmination of a life of faith to go to be where Christ's feet had walked. And the greatest thing that happened was that when she decided she was going to go, her son volunteered to come with her because he too wanted to be in Christ's footsteps. So they booked their ticket straight away, spent a whole year looking forward to it. But in that year, her son contracted a very serious form of cancer. And when the trip came, he wasn't able to travel with her. And so the shoes that she was wearing were his shoes, because she wanted him to have the chance to walk in the footsteps of Christ. What faith, what love, and how humble. And bringing back such memories, we were in Bethlehem Square of another mother who'd given birth with humbleness, humility, with love, with faith, and yet, like Phyllis, knew that she was at one point likely to watch her son die. And I felt so humbled by that. I felt ashamed that I, like everybody else, had judged the book by the cover. And we do it so easily, we don't get a chance to actually know what's going on inside people. But actually, inside each of us is a precious person, the person that God created when he held us in the palm of his hand. And with all of our abilities, all of our limitations, God knows us. And it's that precious person in each of us that we often just don't catch sight of. And I was so humbled not just by Phyllis's love for her son, but by Phyllis's love for God's son.
Yeah.
dear Lord and Father of mankind. And we haven't got many fathers here today, but we have a lot of mothers and probably grandmothers too. And I think in most households, women are the ones who are the organisers, aren't they, that get everything sorted. Especially, I mean, it's all the year round, I think we're always the organisers. It's something we enjoy doing, but especially at Christmas time. And I love the story that Gervase Finn, have you come across that name? He was a school inspector, writes very funny stories. He said that he was always being accused by his wife of having no idea what she wanted at Christmas. But then on the Christmas where he gave her screen wash because he knew she needed it, and tea towels because she obviously did so much washing up, she must love doing it and have nice stuff. So anyway, eventually the message got through, the penny dropped, and there was the Christmas that he thought, I'm going to really try and get her something personal, even romantic. And he was very brave. He plucked up courage to go to the local lingerie shop. And he bought her a beautiful lacy underwear in the festive colour of red, which he wrapped all by himself and put under the Christmas tree so that on Christmas morning, she unwrapped it in front of their two sons and his mother, who marched across the room and put her arm around his wife's shoulders and said, just ignore him, dear. His father went through a stage like that. But the thing is that what the family had missed was that he'd actually put a lot of love into that gift. And surely love must be at the heart of all the gifts we give, whether they're presents or anything that we do for anybody. And actually, if we don't have love in what we do for other people, then nothing really means anything, does it? So I'm just going to share with you a bit of a rewrite of that famous reading read at weddings, 1 Corinthians 13. But it's obviously it's aimed at Christmas, but I think the thoughts in it will touch the heart of any of us who have families or perhaps are homemakers. I can put up all those twinkling lights, tinsel and shiny baubles and trim the tree with hand-crocheted nativity figures. But without love, I'm just a decorator. I can slave away baking dozens of mince pies and cordon bleu cuisine, which I'll serve on a Christmas table set with coordinated china, tablecloth and serviettes that look much classier than the ladies next door. But without love, I'm just another cook. I can head off to the shops with a long list of presents that I wrap, label and deliver right on time. But if I do it all out of a sense of habit and duty rather than love, I'm just a delivery man. I can send charity Christmas cards, I can sing carols along with the radio and even make the occasional church service. But without a love of Christ at the heart of it all, I've missed the point. Love stops cooking to hug the child. Love takes a break from writing Christmas cards to kiss the husband. Love delays peeling vegetables and stuffing the turkey to ring an old friend I've not spoken to all year. Love doesn't yell at the kids to get out of the way, but is thankful they're there to be in the way. Love doesn't only give to those who are able to give in return, but rejoices in giving to those who can't. Love makes sense of Christmas. It bears all things, it believes all things, it hopes all things and endures all things. Love never fails. Oh, we ladies will grow out of that fancy new outfit or this year's electronic gadget, which will be old news by next Christmas. But the gift of love is a blessing forever. Right, well, now on to a hymn. That it's a modern hymn, There Is a Redeemer. It was written by Melanie Green, who I think we could only describe as being a child of the 60s, really, you know, flower power. She was in California and sort of searching for truth and life. And she ended up meeting someone who was also on that search, Keith Green. And they got married in the early 1970s. And actually together, they found what they were searching for in the Gospel of Christ, and they set up a Christian music ministry which became very well known across the whole of the States, and it was based on wonderful songs that they wrote, and one of them is this one, There Is a Redeemer. And they wrote this, or she started writing it, she began it, she has three verses, and she wrote the first two verses in 1977, and at that time
he decided he wanted to write the last verse. And as we sing it, just think about what he says in those last lines, because it's so relevant to what happened a few years later in 1982. Keith took their two eldest children on a real treat because one of the neighbours had a light plane and suggested that he took Keith and the two kids up for a quick spin. And there was a crash, and Melanie was at home. She had a two-year-old there, toddler, and she was pregnant with a fourth child, and she had the news that her husband and children had died. But because of the words of this song and how he almost saw the future when he would be with God, she took tremendous comfort from the words of this song. And it's a lovely modern song for us to sing together. Shall we stand to sing, "There Is a Redeemer"? Take on new meaning when you know the story, don't they? Well, we're going to sing another hymn now, which has helped people in difficult times. This is "Nearer, My God, to Thee." Now, this is a hymn that's been held in great affection for many, many years, since it was written back in Victorian times by a lady called Sarah Flower Adams. Isn't that a nice name? And she was actually an actress, a British actress, and she was known for her roles in Shakespeare. But she was a very devoted Christian, and she wrote quite a lot of hymn texts. And she wrote this one, "Nearer, My God, to Thee," that did become quite well known, and particularly in the Methodist movement. It was often sung, both here and in the States too, at times when great comfort was needed or reassurance that God was close by. But it is iconically known for the occasion when it was sung on the Titanic, which set sail from Southampton on the 10th of April 1912, and then 4 days later hit an iceberg, and
1,500 people died in that terrible catastrophe. But so many people, passengers who did survive, talked about the band that played as the boat sank. And the band leader was a name called Wallace Hartley, whose father was a Methodist choir master, and he knew this hymn very well and had actually chosen it to be played at his own funeral. And so it's said that the very last hymn that was sung was "Nearer, My God, to Thee." Would you like to sit and sing this lovely song? The story we were telling. I wish we'd thought of that. It was lovely. Thank you very much indeed. And that sense of God being near was something which was needed at the end of her life by the wonderful lady Edith Cavell, who was a World War I British nurse who celebrated for saving the lives of many, many soldiers in Brussels from all sides, all nationalities. And with her Belgian and her French colleagues, she helped over 200 Allied soldiers to escape from German-occupied Belgium. But she was arrested. She was tried with 33 others by a German military court. She was found guilty of assisting men to the enemy and was shot by a German firing squad on the 12th of October 1915. Now, this was written by the Reverend H. Sterling Gahan, who was one of the last people to see her before her execution. And this is what he said. "On Monday evening, the 11th of October, I was admitted by special passport from the German authorities to the prison of St. Gilles, where Miss Edith Cavell had been confined for 10 weeks. The final sentence had been given early that afternoon. To my astonishment and relief, I found my friend perfectly calm and resigned, but this could not lessen the tenderness and the intensity of feeling on either part during that last interview of almost an hour. She wished all her friends to know that she willingly gave her life for her country and said, 'I have no fear nor shrinking. I have seen death so often that it is not strange or fearful to me.' And she further said, 'I thank God for this 10 weeks quiet before the end. Life has always been hurried and full of difficulty. This time of rest has been a great mercy. They've all been very kind to me here, But this I would say, standing as I do in the view of God and eternity, I realise that patriotism is not enough. I must have no hatred or bitterness towards anyone. We partook of the Holy Communion together, and she received the gospel message of consolation with all her heart. And at the close of the little service, I began to repeat the words of "Abide with me," and softly she joined in. "Abide with me, fast falls the eventide. The darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide." We sat quietly talking until it was time for me to go, and she gave me parting messages for relations and friends. She spoke of her soul's needs at that moment, and she received the assurance of God's word as only a Christian can do. And then I said goodbye, and she smiled and said, "We shall meet again." The German military chaplain was with her at the end and afterwards gave her a Christian burial. And he told me she was brave and bright to the last. She confessed her Christian faith and she was glad to die for her country. She died like a heroine. Isn't that a moving story? We all have our memories of this hymn, "Abide with me," in our own families, our own experience. But let's sit once again and prayerfully, remembering that story and our own, sing "Abide with me."
Father of all wisdom, come to him and bless his name. Mercy he has shown us, his love is forever, faithful to the end of days. Come then, all you nations, sing of your Lord's goodness, melodies of praise and thanks to God. Ring out the Lord's glory, praise him with your music, worship him and bless his name. I think we've just done that, haven't we? Shall we pray? Loving God, we've sung our hearts out to you this morning. We are so grateful for your presence in our lives. And we rejoice that Jesus is alive today and every day. Help us to sing your praises in the good times and in the not so good times. To spread the message of your love and goodness with a smile on our faces and joy in our hearts across this world. Amen. And a blessing. May our hearts sing of love, pouring out upon a tree. May our hearts sing of peace that can calm an angry sea. May our hearts sing of joy in forgiveness, grace, mercy. May our hearts sing of faith in a God who sets us free. May our hearts sing of life lived well and abundantly. May our hearts sing always. Amen.
Well, that brings us almost to our last song today, and it's a wonderful song for, to send us off for the rest of the day to come. Just to let you know that a lot of you may know I write a lot of books. I've written about 27 or something, but I've just bought a few, and two books that have each got 40 hymns in, all very familiar ones, but with this kind of stories I've been sharing with you today. So if you'd like those, and also there's a trilogy there, the latest trilogy I've written, which is called Hope Hall, which is about a community centre that's based in an old memorial hall next door to an old school that's been made into a community centre, and it's spring, summer and Christmas, three books throughout a year with lots of core stories going through, romance and a lot of challenge, tears, laughter, all the kind of things I've talked to you about really. So you might like that as well. But I'll be over there in a little while and I can sign them for you. And if you've already got some, please let me sign them for you before we go. It's just reminded me to ask you, when you were coming here today, did any of you think that you were going to hear Pam Ayres? Exactly. I knew somebody would, because that's happened so many times that people have thought that, you know, that I should be about to say poetry. And there was the occasion when she came to Bedford Town Hall, which is near where we lived, and Richard and I went along, and at the end she had lots of books to sell. And so we queued up with like everybody else, and we were second from the front. And the man in front said to her, he was so excited to meet her, really, really excited. And then he suddenly said, and do you know, the other Pam I've always wanted to meet is Pam Rhodes. So Richard tapped him on the shoulder and said, you should turn around, you might have a nice surprise. And it was, oh, great, you know, delight and squeals and everything. It was lovely. And then we went up to talk to Pam. It was the first time I'd met her. And she said, I'm very glad to meet you because I keep being asked to sing hymns. So, but anyway, it was lovely. And we got our books and got them signed. And as we were walking back, we walked past the man who was behind us, and he said, well, the Pamela that I've always wanted to meet is Pamela Anderson. So I'm sorry it's only me, really, but we're going to go out on a great hymn, which actually means a lot to women everywhere. Now, let me just ask you, first of all, do you know what the nation's favourite hymn has been nearly every year in the 36 years I've been on? How Great Thou Art. Absolutely. Every single year, and all the polls we've done on Songs of Praise in 36 years of me being on the programme, except for one year, which was the Brexit year. And the hymn that was chosen then was Jerusalem, and did those, because it's very patriotic, isn't it? Interesting, though, it was written back in the 18th century, or the words were, written by William Blake, who was a very complex man. He wrote beautiful poetry, deeply committed to his Christian faith, but he was a bit of a free thinker. So there was a lot of sort of, you know, discussion about his work then and his work now, I think, over the years. But wonderful, wonderful words. And it was sometime later, in 1916, in March, that those words were given a melody called Jerusalem, written by Sir Hubert Parry. He wrote that wonderful melody. He called it Jerusalem, and he wrote it because March 1916, just coming up to the Great War, it was a rallying call for both men and women to play their part with the war that they knew was coming. And it was 2 years later, in 1918, well, that was such an important year for women, because until that time, the only people who were allowed to vote in this country were male persons. But in 2018, at the beginning of that year, an act was passed which said that women over the age of 30, because you had to be sure that they were actually sensible enough, but also householders or married to householders would be allowed to have the vote. And it was a chink, you know what do I mean, chink in the wall, wasn't it? The brick wall that had been up. And there was great celebration, you can imagine, amongst all the women who had supported the suffragette movement. And thousands of them came to the Royal Albert Hall at the start of 1918 to celebrate what had happened. And in that event that evening, they sang this hymn, Jerusalem. And afterwards, they said they wanted it forever to be known as the Women Voters Hymn. And it wasn't long after that that the Women's Institute decided to adopt it as their anthem. And what a wonderful hot song that's been for them. And of course, promenaders have enthusiastically sung it at the last night of the proms since the 1950s. So I think we should finish off today by singing this song in celebration of women everywhere, especially all of us. Shall we stand to sing Jerusalem?
Through her sense of humour. But I think most importantly, thank you for being such an ambassador for our faith.
Absolutely. Thank you. Well, thank you.